When wilt thou save the people, O God of mercy, when? The people, Lord, the people, not thrones and crowns, but men.
I'd like to introduce our next speaker, and that is Dr. Ed Park. I always enjoy introducing people from Harvard because I think it really says something. But Dr. Park graduated from Harvard University, and he just didn't graduate. He had to graduate with honors in biological anthropology. He just didn't do biology. He wanted to do biological anthropology prior to earning his medical degree, and a master's in public health from Columbia, another, you know, okay school, in New York. He became one of the first patients to begin the regular ingestion of plant-based telomerase activators. The results were so astonishing to him that he founded the Recharge Biomedical Clinic in Orange County in California in 2008. He's since become one of the leading medical experts in this exciting field of regenerative medicine. Our next speaker, Dr. Ed Park.
Good morning, everybody. Oh, that was pretty weak. This is my first time talking in front of a large audience, so if you could help me feel more comfortable, I would appreciate it. So, all right, thank you. Okay, so good morning, Dr. Park. Let's see what. So today we're going to talk a lot about what Dr. Shea mentioned, and I want to leave time for questions in the end because I find going through med school that my questions always seemed really stupid to me, and that so those are sometimes the most illuminating. So I will leave time at the end. One of the hallmarks of insanity is grandiosity, which I believe I have, and another one is
this mic working? I'm gonna check this mic.
Religiosity.
Mic check.
I don't think this works. Does this work? Okay. Well, then I have to hunch away. Anyway, so this will be very religious. It may touch on some baby boom music. I'm not a baby boomer. Anyone, let's do a little test. I'm not a baby boomer, but just applaud if you think I'm in a certain age range, okay? 65 and up. Thank you. Thank you. 55 to 65. Oh, thank you. 45 to 55. Yes. My erudition, I'm not even wearing a tie. Okay. 35 to 45, good. 25 to 35, come on, where's the love? Okay, you'll see me by the pool later and you might change your mind. So I believe that I'm just gonna bless the crowd, bless you for listening, and I'm not literally that religious, but I think we're entering a new age. So I just think that the things that we share, everybody sitting here praying that this guy's not boring or crazy, we all share the idea that we're pioneers and we believe in the goodness and the abundance of being alive. I think so. I mean, everybody here is glad to be alive, right? Good, because if you're not, you know, I'm on the 30th floor, you can come visit me. We consider everything, we have open minds, but we reserve the right to judge everything. And we believe it's better to be well-informed. They used to say better read than dead, and I think it's better well-read than dead in this case. And I think it's important to be grateful in whatever we do in life, to be grateful, as that will enhance our appreciation. This morning I was kind of nervous, so I looked out on the ocean and I saw that the world was apparently round. I don't know if you know this, but for a long time people thought the world was flat. And there are a lot of people who were smart who measured angles of obelisks and looked at. I challenge you to look out there and look at if you're on a railing, look at the railing and look that the Earth's horizon goes up and it comes back down. The world is not flat. But for a long time, people got in trouble with the church for saying it was round. And the model on the right was the predominant common knowledge, received wisdom, that this was a flat Earth. Now, if I come up here and I say, I'm from Harvard, and I went to Columbia, and I published papers saying that the world is flat, you can choose to believe me or not. But I would hope that people here who are like, is that guy for real? Just go home and Google it, and you'll find that pretty much everything I'm saying hopefully is true. So anyway, this is a kind of a hackneyed aphorism, but it's true, I think. It says by Schopenhauer, All truth passes through three stages. First, it's ridiculed, then it's violently opposed, and then it's accepted as being self-evident. So I hope to get you all to that place where I'm at, where my theory of aging is based on telomeres, and it appears self-evident to me. So let's do another cheesy audience participation thing. Who here has won the lottery? Applause. Nobody. Okay, well, I got this from A4M last year. Somebody said, if you're one of 20 million sperm, then technically you've won the lottery, right? I mean, what makes you guys so special? I mean, there were 19,999,909. Hey, dumb luck. Okay, so you're feeling kind of disempowered. That's fine. All right, so I want everyone to start, and we'll see how the numbers diminish. So everybody, please raise your hand. Say, I've won the lottery. I was one of 20 million sperm. Anyone? Anyone? Thank you. Yay, I'm the winning sperm. I won the race. Okay, now, who here believes in the Bible, the Quran, or the Tanakh? Abrahamic religions? Shout out, Abrahamic religions. You in the back. Okay, good. Now, who believes that Noah actually lived greater than 900 years? Methuselah. Like, literally 900 years. Dude, yeah, you're literal. That's good. So there's one guy. So we walk a line between science and belief, and we'll just leave it at that. I don't have any particular agenda there. Well, let's start on the other purview. Who here wants to be 100 in good health? Yes, my people, good. And who thinks science will allow our average life expectancy to get there? Pretty good number. Yeah, that's right. You drove out here. You flew out here. I hope so. Now, who here wants to live 1,000 years? Bill, I know you. That's your whole, yeah, raison d'etre. Okay, so like 5 people want to live 1,000 years. Okay, so why is that? I believe that in getting into, I'm not an anti-aging medicine doc, but when I pitch this, everyone says, oh, I don't want to be old. And why? Why is that? Because there's a hidden narrative. There's the hidden assumption that you're going to be infirmed. Okay, that's a fixed compass point, like the flat earth. But people also think it's wrong. So let's talk about why it's wrong. In this culture, we were raised with the Abrahamic religion. So on the left, we got the big guy and Adam and Eve. And on the right, we got where we're all heading, some kind of gruesome Hieronymus Bosch nightmare. And we're somewhere in the middle of this triptych. We're trying to have as much fun as we can without damaging our telomeres and our nervous system. And, you know, eventually, this is kind of our worldview in a nutshell. So what's the hidden narrative about longevity pursuit? Is that it's wrong. I mean, God really doesn't want us to live that long. And that may be true. I mean, I didn't mention it here, but there's the thing about the flood where people were, you know, sinful upon the earth and God flooded everyone and reset the counter. I mean, I believe literally, as does Bill and dude in row 16, that we can live to be 1,000. But it's funny, people who are quite religious and towards the orthodox interpretation don't believe that we can live 900 years. They believe that people walked with dinosaurs and that God literally created the earth in 8 days or 6 days. But somehow that's crazy. That's not literal. That's like, you know, allegorical. So this is the quote from the passage. It says, Samuel L. Jackson, and the Lord God said, man has become like one of us, knowing good and evil. He must not be allowed to reach his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever. So this is deep in our subconscious that, I don't know, most people don't realize there were two trees, and that's the usual interpretation. There was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, which you can, I guess, think of as consciousness. We're all sitting here knowing we're going to die. And then there was a second tree, which was the tree of eternal life. So again, it's up to you what you want to believe. But this whole be careful what you wish for thing is so much a part of who we are as people, and yet I reject that. I don't think that's the case. I don't think people really, I think it's the threat of hope that people are concerned about. But if you look at the history of our collective consciousness, you know, Scheherazade, Hans Christian Andersen, Dickens, Twilight Zone, everything is like an ironic comeuppance. If you want something, you gotta pay for it, and you pay for it in spades. Like, don't know if you remember that Burgess Meredith episode where he wanted to be alone to read, and all of a sudden he's the last guy in the post-apocalyptic world and his glasses break. Well, I think that's kind of the subtext of what we're talking about. So everybody here, when I've pitched, you know, what I've gone through, everyone just looks at me and goes, wow, too good to be true. Move on. Okay, so let's move on. So I feel a little bit like the dude there in the unitard or the toga. I'm kind of like, you people are all pretty accomplished in your fields. I mean, there's a lot of PhDs, MDs, and I came new to this. I don't know. If you could walk up to me and say, I'm Dr. DeSilva, or I'm Dr., you know, so-and-so, Gardner, I'd be like, okay, great, because I don't really know this field. I'm new to it. So I feel like I'm kind of looking out on the Coliseum, and I may say a lot of stupid things, but I've endowed myself with that prerogative. So, so let's delve into a little bit of what we're talking about. I went to Harvard, graduated with a BA in anthropology. I'm not a baby boomer, born in 67, and if you want a mnemonic, it's 4664. Baby boom is 46 to 64. I went to Columbia for my MD and master's in public health, and then I went back to Harvard Medical School at Beth Israel to do OBGYN training, and I was in private practice for 15, 16 years. My life changed when my father was diagnosed with brain cancer, and as a physician, he knew it was not good, and he went ahead and did all the treatments, and he lasted in a really diminished state of living 2.5 years, but that kind of put me into a crisis, so I went ahead, I had kids 4 and 8 at that time, and I decided to look up Google for the first time in my life why people get old. And I think that if you do that and you have an open mind, then you really see that there's a lot of theories out there, but one seems very robust, and that's the telomere theory of aging. So I became aware of telomerase, and I went through a midlife crisis. I wanted to be a screenwriter, so I learned how to be a screenwriter. I even wrote a few screenplays. One of them is a sci-fi based on telomerase activation, because I started to think, well, what happens if people could live longer? You know, could everybody afford it? Probably not. And so how would we decide? And would there be an uprising? And so if those kind of questions turn you on, which they do to me, I have a graphic novel, which I'll plug at the end. I don't have a real science book, but I have a graphic novel. So I went ahead and got interested in telomerase. And then on 777, a company announced that they had a nutraceutical activator. So I flew out, and I looked at the whole thing, looked at the safety data, the white sheets, and I said, hey, okay, this doesn't seem like BS. I'll try it, even though it's quite expensive. And I didn't really feel anything, but in 4 months, I just completely transformed to a new person. So I didn't really tell anyone. You sound kind of like a whack job. So I would go back, and people would come in for their annual pap smears or what have you, and they would say, you look like a totally different person. I said, oh, yeah, thanks, you know. It was kind of like an insult, like, oh my God, you look so good. What happened? You know, so it's like, thanks. But I lost 20 pounds, and I just felt younger. And so I thought, well, maybe there is something to this. So I signed up after being, I think, patient 19 or so. I signed up to be one of the first doctors. And I just slowly, you know, friends and relatives, and it kind of built. If you want to learn more about that journey, then you should go to the Sunday morning talk at 7 a.m. when we'll just hash out anecdotes, and you can fire away your questions and everything. But my goals for this talk, what's the time? Okay, are really just to help you understand my stem cell theory of aging, so you can go home and Google it and weigh for yourself, and explain to you why I believe that life is an abundant thing, and explain to you why I don't really believe in cancer, aging, or original sin. I mean, I literally don't believe in aging or cancer. And if these things do exist, that they're just illusions, you know. So that's kind of heretical. I hope you don't throw fruit. I don't think they served any fruit. Actually, the breakfast ran out quite early. So, okay, so let's talk about my telomere test at the end, too, which touches upon not a product endorsement, but something else. Here's a picture. Anybody know where this is? It's a soft toss. Someone shout it out. It's still awake. Cleveland, the Garden of Eden in Cleveland. That's right. She's saying, I can't believe the Indians can't win the pennant. No, this is not Cleveland. This is Eve, and so she's pointing up. This is kind of like a story here. She's saying, but dude, okay, I know we're in trouble, but there's another tree here. She's looking up. She's saying, let's try this one. And he's saying, oh, I don't know. I feel pretty good about myself, and everyone, all the animals and I have dominion over are telling me I'm looking good here in my birthday suit. So that's kind of where we're at. So let's look at the literal scientific evolutionary. Not that I believe in evolution, because there might be some intelligent designers here, but I got to go with what people tell me, because I don't have time to do all the research. So, fact. On the left, we have a protist. It's a circular genome. So this thing can reproduce like a soap bubble. It splits into two. Pas de problème. Easy. On the right, we have the tree of life, if you believe in that sort of thing. And on the left branch is all the protists. Oops. Is this a pointer? No, yes. Okay. So these are the dudes with circular DNA. These are the other ones, archaea. These broke off and are kind of dead, or these are in sulfur tubes. But anyway, fungi, plants, protozoans, anyway, anything with a nucleus. So what's a nucleus? A nucleus allows you to have linear chromosomes. They read from one end to the other, 3' to 5', or vice versa. So this is why we need telomeres, because we can encode a lot more information. So let's look at what a telomere is. A telomere, quite literally, is like this paperclip. You can see on the bottom right that the end of the structure actually folds in on itself, and there's an overhang. And as scientists, we love all this stuff, the binding proteins and everything, the structure. It's really, really cool. Conceptually, what we see on the lower left is that chromatin is this big old bow tie X, and at the end, there's always these blank leaders. And they're just caps like shoelace caps, okay? And on the upper left, we see that the caps must erode. This is strictly a mechanical thing. You can see some cool animations, but you just literally can't get the RNA primer to the end. So the thing must shorten. One thing that you can accept on the face of it is that telomerase is all good and never bad. I mean, there's a lot of people with degrees and Nobel Prizes who say that telomerase is bad. Telomerase causes cancer. And so I think that's one of the major stopping points for a lot of people. I mean, it was for me. I looked at the data that was provided, the Ames assay, the nude mice assay. Decided, hey, you know, probably not. And people have been taking what I've been taking for 5 years. You know, you can count on one hand the number of people that have gotten malignancy. But let's try and argue that telomerase is good, because people will say, well, 90% of tumors or cancers have telomerase. What's up with that? Well, I think it's just a proxy for stemness. So if you say, well, you know, 90% of supervillains have nostrils, okay, great. You've just established a profound truth. The ability to breathe through your nose is, you know, it's absurd. So let's look back and see nature's model for telomerase deficiency, dyskeratosis congenita. So if you have a half gene dose, they call it a gene dose, if you only have one copy of the telomerase RNA template, what's your life expectancy? 12. So that's not good. Does anybody think that's normal to die of old age at 12? I mean, I think that's, people would say that's abnormal. But somehow we accept that we're supposed to become infirmed in our 80s and die. So people have internalized the wrong message. Telomerase keeps us young, and it's a good thing. You look at Ashkenazi centenarians out of, I think it was Albert Einstein, it's a limited genetic drift population, and they looked at them and said the people with the higher telomerase got to be 100. Sorry, sometimes my gesticulations become a little bit, because I trained at Beth Israel, so they made me an honorary member, so, you know, sometimes. Anyway, so if you had a lot of telomerase, you got to 100. Simple as that. There are trees that live 5,000 years. I mean, they're not worried about the moral repercussions of living 5,000 years. They just happen to have active telomerase, so. I believe that what we're doing when we do all the healthy lifestyle habits, eating well, meditating, sleeping, a lot of them could be mediated through telomerase activity. Our body has time to repair what it needs to repair in the stem cells. And in particular, I believe that sleep is incredibly important, not just for mental, but for physical recuperation. So a lot of the medicine I've been practicing for the last 4 years, I believe, is deeply tied in with sleep. Telomerase is inducible. We'll go a little bit into that. And I think the key part of this model that I'm going to propose to you is apoptosis, that the system, such as it is not designed, or it just exists in a way that errors are expected, errors are normal, it's good. There's replacement of the stem cells. So Let's look at these. I love metaphors. I love visual metaphors. So we got a firecracker on the upper right. So the telomeres are burning, and eventually, if it gets to the fuse, you're in trouble. Okay? Bottom left, again, a beautiful, elegant picture of the message. It's A-G-G-G-A-T-T, something like that. It's six base pairs. And what's interesting is that for fungi, it could be like 22, 23. For all plants on this earth, it's seven. So again, the message is unimportant. It's blank leader, like the old Ampex tapes. It's just, it's got to be something. It's guanine rich, but it doesn't matter. But all eukaryotes, all plants and animals, and this is probably the only take-home point. Walk around, look at the palm trees. Everybody, everything, all plants and animals require telomerase to preserve their stem cells. So what is, let's get down to the nitty-gritty here. So here we have a mashup of the telomerase thing. And people will say to me, hey, doc, why don't I just take telomerase? I go, oh, yeah, you could do that, but your pepsin in your stomach will dissolve enzymes. So a lot of people, I know there's a guy saying, swallow RNA and DNA, it's all good. You know, we can consider that. We can do experiments, but I mean, some theories are better than others. So if you swallow this bad boy, it ain't getting into nothing. It's going to be broken down into its component amino acids. So telomerase is assembled and for use only in that nucleus. It doesn't cross the cell membrane either. It's only for use in that cell. It has to be made and purposed for that nucleus. And which cells are they? Stem cells. So what's in a stem cell? A stem cell has the ability to splice this key. The key would be this RNA template. So the whole process of telomerase action is this blob, this micro machine, is going to pump out GGGTTT, and it's got subunits, and here's the template. And Dr. Andrews, who won the Inventor of the Year award for inducing a typo very mischievously, he did a typo in this template, and he proved exactly the sequence wherein those six things were stamped out. So he, being the mad genius that he is, established that yeah, it's just a simple signal. So this is the RNA template, and the kids with diskeratin, instead of having an abnormality or diskeratosis congenita, it's not a problem with the RNA so much as the diskeratin. So what's the diskeratin? That's this other little protein. It's like the keyhole, really. So if the key is spliced correctly, then it'll fit the keyhole, and there'll be some kind of change allowing the telomerase reverse transcriptase to interact with the end. So on your non-stem cells, you can't lengthen because the diskeratin is blocking. And so I think, I mean, this is more or less, you can correct me if I'm wrong at the end, Bill, but I think that's pretty much the gist of it. So on the upper left, we see the fate of a stem cell is blue. It's all good, straight to the right. This is like your sperm and eggs. They're immortal, and we live for them in a way. On the bottom left is the curve of a differentiated non-telomerase active cell. Just, it goes kaplooey. That's the Hayflick limit that Dr. Shea talked about. And somewhere in the middle are stem-like cells. So I want you to think of stemness as two things. It's the ability to reproduce in perpetuity by telomerase. And there's degrees. It's not all or nothing. You have degrees. And as you lose potentiality, gain differentiation, then you lose the telomerase activity in general. I mean, you can induce pluripotency by introducing transfecting genes, but by and large, that's the normal way of things. I don't know if that was incredibly boring or what. So we're looking at progerias now. So let's look at progeria, which is premature aging. On the bottom, there's problems with DNA transcription, and on the top half, there are the progerias, which involve, well, in the red, the DNA repair. Helicases, which are winding and unwinding proteins. And Hutchison-Gilford is a scaffolding protein that makes the lamin A that's required for pulling apart and sorting chromosomes. And then telomerase, in its various forms, are problems usually with diskeratin, but I think they can be with the RNA, too. So the most specific model for aging, premature aging, tells us something, that telomerase is inherently important. And what do these other things share? Excuse me. they're all DNA repair things. So job number one of the cell, you got, it's like 6 gigabytes of information. A lot of it arguably is not needed, but it came along with the package as we evolved. So it's all about the DNA repair at the end. Okay, major diversion here, perhaps. Anybody here seen the movie The Name of the Rose? Oh, same guy. Okay, good. Good, about 24. Excellent movie. Sean Connery plays William of Baskerville, which is kind of a hat tip to Conan Doyle's Sherlock Holmes. And it's based on this guy who everyone likes to quote, William of Occam, Occam's razor. So what is Occam's razor? Basically, it's, I didn't take Latin, but it's pluralitas non est ponenda sine necessitate. I think that just means don't come up with a bunch of explanations when one will do. And we all learned that. It's a pretty sound principle. Not always true, but I think that will hold true for the rest of the talk. We're going to talk about why it's better or simpler or more elegant to talk about telomere shortening rather than evoke oxidation, SIR2, I don't know, resveratrol, God's punishment. It's just simpler. I mean, any one of those could be right. But anyway, this is a really cool movie. I recommend you see it. So he goes around trying to solve a murder, and it turns out that the inquisitor and all the people involved with the murder want him to believe that it was demonic possession, when in fact he follows the clues and he finds out it was just a conspiracy over hiding one of the priests' homosexuality, and then they destroyed the last copy of Aristotle's Comedics. It's funny, there's two classics alluded to in Aristotle. There's Poetics, which talks about how to write drama, and then there's Comedics, which talks about how to make fun of people in authority and everything. And so that was deemed inappropriate and not saved even by Arabic culture through the Dark Ages. Okay, so replicatives. I drone on. Sometimes I don't know if anyone's listening. Anybody still awake out there? Okay, so I don't know. Sometimes I go, what's he talking about? Oh, let's forget it. So replicative senescence, back to being grounded here. On the upper left, we see that the chromosomes have shortened to the point to which they're uncapped. This is what you need to understand. When it's uncapped, the existing machinery of the cell sees it as a DNA double-strand break. It won't abide that. It doesn't know. It's just all base pairs to the mechanism. So it will anneal one end, one naked end, to another one, much like the trapeze artists on the right. But imagine if the trapeze artists were connected by crazy glue. I mean, they could tear off anywhere, and that's what we're really seeing. So on the bottom left, when the cells line up at the metaphase bridge and they're pulled apart, you know, if Jim and Sally there are glued together, maybe the arm is going to get ripped off, maybe at the waist. And that's what we see from this cancer, small cell cancer, on the bottom right. We see that on the upper left, chromosome 1, turquoise has broken off from somewhere else and gone to yellow. Just accept that they've color-coded these chromosomes. And so you see a fragment of the yellow over on the turquoise. No big surprise. So once you start making mistakes, look, there's no copy of 20. There's three copies of, I don't know, 16. The number of bad things that can happen is literally infinite. And so it's just confetti time there. You're in trouble. But luckily, you're not in trouble because we have an ability to kill based on bad chromosome numbers. It's apoptosis, which we'll get back to. So the crux of this model is a stem cell model. So what are stem cells? Again, stem cells, I guess the best analogy would be they're like queen bees. So a queen bee will live years, whereas the drones, which are clones of her, will live months. So in your body, there are these master cells, stem cells, and they're pumping out copies. And that's about it. Now, if you've ever tried to make a copy of a photocopy, you'll see that you will acquire streaks, rotation, blurs. So when you copy from a copy, it's only going to be as good as what you got to copy from. That's pretty obvious. So let's just skip on here. What if we didn't have this mechanism? What if all our cells were stem-like and immortal, as they once believed? Well, we would become like the blob, right? It's not a hard thought experiment to do. If all our cells were immortal, dividing, we'd, like, within hours become giant, unsustainable blobs, and we would die. Now, you can say that was put there for a reason, maybe, but it's just, it is what it is. So another more modern rendition of that would be Jabba the Hutt. So here he's saying, my P53 ain't so good, hon. And so this is kind of what happens without apoptosis, without replicative senescence. And I think this chart has been reproduced. You see two crossing curves. As you go out in generations, you know, whatever the Hayflick limit is for this cell, you get aneuploidy goes up and the viability goes down. Simple as that. So that engages. When the chromosome number at the metaphase bridge check, there's a spindle activation checkpoint. Basically, they pull on the things, and if there's the wrong number, the system can't go. And if it really doesn't like what it sees, every cell and its prime directive is endowed with killing itself. So if you've got a bad number, cell's going to die. It's going to kill itself. So there are multiple mechanisms, but the most fundamental one is called P53, and it does something. I say does, it's very anthropomorphic, but it will engage these systems to poke holes in the mitochondria. So you have these power packs of battery acid, you know, oxidative species. It pokes holes in it, and the cell all of a sudden starts dissolving from the inside. This is not an aberration. This is good. If we didn't, we'd have a lot of problems. So cells, as their major prime function, is to kill themselves when they get damaged, and that's a good thing. So I propose that perhaps a lot of the inflammation we see with aging and with all these chronic diseases perhaps is not a bad thing or causal. Perhaps it's like the firemen. So what you have is cells that are stuck in a state. They're trying to kill themselves. They're pouring out all this species, but for some reason they're not bad enough to really do the final death harry-carry. So if you think about it, inflammation is always in a state like coagulation of constant repair. So you want to kill these cells, you want to clear them, and in their stead, new stem cells, the mesenchymal stem cells that you may have heard about, are the ones that come in and they repopulate. A gentleman asked about cancer, and this is a really important issue. The Salk Institute about a month ago came out with a study saying that all the modalities, chemo, radiation, they seem to be working by engaging cell death by P53. So basically, you know, I did this mashup to kind of explain cancer treatment such as it is. So if we look at cancer treatment and we treat the ground as the clinically evident cancer, and the best thing is surgery. Cut it out. If it hasn't metastasized, you're cured. As we go up in our treatment ladder, we have radiation, which is often localized, and again, attacking rapidly producing cells. So that's better. Chemo, of course, would be the least specific. It's sort of like dropping a neutron bomb. And so that will kill all healthy reproducing cells. And we just hope, like in a hostage situation, that if we poison everyone, that the good guys will outnumber in the end. In some ways, I think that we're kind of in the dark ages of cancer treatment, because if that's all we got, it's pretty dismal. It's like, and people may look back on this age and say, wow, I can't believe you did that, Grandpa. I can't believe you poisoned people. What were you thinking? But, you know, that is orthodoxy currently. And if you look under the ground, which is something that no one really considers except research scientists, what we see is that the biggest, I think, and the best way to prevent cancer is just to protect the telomeres, because there are many articles in every cancer model showing that more telomerase erosion corresponds with a higher risk. Now, having said that, a lot of people will say, aha, Mr. Shmavid, so what about these cancers where you have long telomeres? You know, what's up with that? And I think the answer there lies in that the telomerase is activated when the cell is in crisis, and it tries to lengthen. So the average length will go up, but instead of having a fixed cell or apoptotic cell, you get these long dreadlocks, you know, sort of like, so the average length goes up, but it's not going to fix that break. You got a problem in that chromosome. And above that would be P53. Every cell has the program to kill itself. And then above that would be the T cell system and then the natural killers. So there are many ways to address, prevent cancer, but our modalities are really above the line. We need to perhaps be thinking below the line. Okay, so we are, 35 minutes into this? And is this an hour talk? What is this? Oh, 20 minutes, okay. So we're getting near the end. Anybody know what this is? Emperor's new clothes, good. He's wearing his birthday suit. So this could be Adam, all grown up. He's got an entourage now. Everyone says, ah, you're the best, Adam. You know, you look so sexy in your new clothes. So I sometimes feel like this little guy here pointing, like, the guy's naked, the guy's naked. And I do these podcasts and I review the literature, and it just seems kind of obvious that we're talking about the same disease. It all starts to rhyme. And I could be wrong. I could be the guy walking out there naked, but we'll see. We'll meet back here in 10 years and we'll see who was the one. Because right now the emperor is saying, okay, I got a Nobel Prize, you know. I'm the head of Baylor College of Medicine. I got all these letters and citations, and I'm telling you that telomerase activation causes cancer. Okay, I'm telling you that the world is flat. Who are you going to believe? You know, make up your own mind. So let's look at Mr. Havid Shmavid here. So he did a study, got all kinds of press, and Diane Sawyer put him up, and he took these mice and he activated telomerase and he reversed aging. And in their particular situation, they had an engineered aging mouse and they did some kind of tamoxifen key and lock thing, but the proof of principle was there. So people were like, oh my God, it's like science fiction. Someday this might be available for us. And I think indeed it already has been for me, but that's Sunday morning, and not to get Dr. De Silva upset. If you're interested, you can learn more about that. So another proof of principle, and this was back to Maria Blasco, who's like the Mick Jagger and Jimmy Page of this field, in my opinion. She, on the right, did a study, and she had her aging mouse model, and she was able to induce telomerase, and what happened was the kinds of defects in these cells changed. These are end-to-end fusions, like the trapeze artist. These are fragments, breaks, rings, all manner of badness in these histograms dropping to zero. So here, I'm an expert because nobody really is theorizing as to why. I believe that what happens is because the telomeres, along with the centromeres, right, these are the ways that you manipulate the chromosomes, something in the telomeres is blocking the ability of the cell to kill itself. So perhaps the induction of telomerase allows you to get like that last strip screw out of the machine. Who knows? But I believe this is a major reason for clinical improvement, whether it be telomerase activation from a small molecule or from just going to the gym. This is inherent and good in our bodies. So this is the big theory, which I came up with several years ago, which to me, I really don't even believe in, because like I told you, I don't believe in aging. I don't think it's a normal, natural part of life. But axioms, or axia, I don't know, didn't take Latin, but I think that it's something that you accept as given, you know? So let's just accept as given. You can Google it if you want, but let's accept that not everyone's lying to us, and that, in fact, copying DNA causes the telomeres to grow shorter every division. Okay, second thing we can agree upon, stem cells, okay, and cancer stem cells or cancer cells, which could actually maybe just be bad stem cells, not differentiated cells as we were taught in school, but it could be that cancer is a disease of stem cells. So instead of taking Jimmy Olsen, Cub Reporter, you're taking, you know, Clark Kent. It's already endowed with immortality. It's much easier to mess up a superhero than to take a Frankenstein monster and get it to do stuff. So anyway, stem cells, cancer cells, are self-immortalizing by lengthening their telomeres, okay? And a corollary, something that goes kind of part and parcel with that, is that the telomere length in stem cells is dynamic. It lengthens, it shortens, depending upon, yes, oxidative stress, how many times the cell has to run off copies, environmental effects, UV, how much quality time it has to repair. Thirdly, axiomatic is that differentiated or non-stem cells can't be any younger or healthier than their queen bee host, right? So like if I'm running off a drone from queen bee, I can't all of a sudden remember how to be a germ cell or lengthen my telomere. You're copying from another template. So all the differentiated cells are only as healthy or as young as their most recent ancestor. A corollary of that would be that since the cellular adaptive immune system is stem-like in nature, it gets older. And that's reflected in the higher rates of cancer, yes, and infection. So you look at a guy like Jack Lane, maximally telomerase active. He's juicing, he's exercising, finger push-up. What does he die of? A cold. It's because he had no more blank keys for his active immune system. And that's what we see. It's validated in the epidemiologic literature. People who make it to 90 and 100, they're good. They have good immune systems. They're fighting off cancer. They don't have atherosclerosis in the way that most people do. But it's the cold. They don't have the blank keys to get the next cold and flu. They get pneumonia. They think, I'm Jack LaLanne, I'm going to be fine, and they're dead. So, the fourth axiom is that for non-stem cells, which don't produce telomerase, the Hayflick limit causes apoptosis, right? So the fuses burn out the P53, they kill themselves. And teleologically, no pun intended, but teleologically means arguing backwards. That's what protects us from, rogue cell lines that have acquired changes, and from DNA transcription, all these other problems. So the hypothesis was, is, and maybe will be in 10 years, that aging is caused by the shortening of telomeres in stem cells. Again, the aging of telomeres in the stem cells. And that if the stem cell telomerase can be activated and protect the telomeres, then the effects of aging may be slowed or potentially reversed. That's all I'm asking you to believe. So anyway, this is my first lecture, and I thank you for your patience. We're basically looking at a situation where everyone here has some hope, has some abundance. They think that there's a cure. They're not sure. But we have, you know, budget crisis, Social Security, Medicare. But think about the FDA lobbying. Think about the people who have dollars in Washington. These people, their incentives are not always aligned with ours. So we have, to coin a phrase, a medical industrial complex. I mean, a lot of people depend on us to get sick and ill. And I think that the truth is really out there. And I think that eventually we'll have to reckon with the fact that aging is not normal, it's not preventable, and we'll turn the ship around. So to quote Bob Dylan, which side are you on? It really doesn't matter. I mean, you could say, I believe in this, that, or the other. If you're a normal person 100 years ago, it doesn't matter if you believe in this God or that deity or do this exercise or grind up this herb. You're going to die. And it's because of not something natural, but because of something in our machinery. And we just don't have enough of the good stuff. So this is me. I think I was 30. Oh, this is 12 years ago. So I was pretty heavy. And if I looked at my pictures, I was pretty skinny in high school and college. But when I hit internship at Beth Israel, you know, you're staying up, you're working 36 hours. It was stress. It was very difficult. You know, if you make a bad decision, if you panic, a baby dies, and people don't like that. So we went from infant mortality of, you know, 1 in 100 to 1 in 10,000. People want a good take-home baby. So it's stressful. So my system went into metabolic syndrome, and I had everything. I had the fatty liver. I had high cholesterol, low testosterone, depression, you know, and I was just fat. I could sniff a Krispy Kreme, and I would gain 10 pounds. So I think that's really what we're looking at as we get older. We try and be good. And we do good things, but especially in the visceral fat, because I'm still pretty heavy in the skin fat, but the visceral fat appears to be, in my opinion, and you can check out my podcast on this, it's aging in the adipocyte stem cells. So I have newer, I hope, stem cells, because there was a period of 10 months where I didn't take anything, and I could still go double cheeseburger. You can't gain weight on this stuff. And I know that sounds too good to be true, but don't believe me. Listen to the testimonials on Sunday. So I'm 44 now, and basically I feel fine. And at that time, I was diagnosed with sleep apnea as an intern. I got married 17, 18 years ago. And when I was measured in 07 for my telomeres, it was pretty long. And I attributed it not to a healthy lifestyle, but just to having good sleep, CPAP, uninterrupted sleep. So it was 9,100. That's long. I mean, if you assume 100 a year, I was like a 9-year-old. With my father passing away, you know, with making some bad investments in everyone thought they were genius day trading in 08, you know, it dropped to 8,400. So I'm thinking, I'm taking the stuff, it dropped, so what's up with that? I feel great, I look great. So again, to this point, It's a dynamic thing. It's like this gentleman, Peter Hildreth. He was busted for somewhere in England walking up for his exercise, walking up the escalator. This, I think, is the best analogy for what happens with telomere length in each individual cell, each individual end. You're trying to lengthen it. You're trying to go up. Now, if you do unhealthy things, if your spouse passes away, you start going backwards or even maybe going down in the wrong direction. So the more healthy things you do, the faster you go up the escalator of aging. Pretty simple. Now I'm up to 9,800. I resume taking my nutraceutical. These are my, Jerry Shea works for Life Length, Maria Blasco's company. This is hot off the presses, one of the, again, pioneers, the first to take it. These are my actual chromosomes on the left. And you can see I'm an outlier here on the right. And let's drill down a bit. So on the top two, we see 9,800. So that's off the charts. And we see the confidence intervals in color code. And you'll get a report like this from Life Length, way above 2 standard deviations. I'm just riding high on that wave there for 44-year-olds. So if you look at the more interesting, because the median length, again, not that interesting. It's kind of like average hair length. What you want to know is the bald spots, I believe. And if you think about it, that's what gets you in trouble. A single chromosome in a single stem cell, if that gets bad, you got a disease unless the system can correct or self-annihilate. So if you look at my percentage of critically short or less than 3,000 base pairs, that's, again, off the charts low. So that puts me like a teenager, too. And I'm not sure that the guy who was carrying his son at 210 pounds had that critically short telomere measure. I think it was much higher. I listened to a lot of these erudite lectures, and I think inherent in what we're doing here is that there's something. There's things that we do. We're actualized. We are in control. And the model we have is like the nuclear control room on the right. We're managing our bioflavonoids. You know, we're worrying about calcium, and we're exercising. We're doing our cardio, and we're all trailblazers. And it's good. It's a good thing. And we think that if we eat well, this is from my cholesterol webinar. If you don't eat as much cholesterol, you're going to be. Of course, it's obvious. It's just as the world is flat. It's obvious. You know, we think that we're in control, and that your diet is like the sun. Okay, genes are like a planet. Aging, it's not even on the charts. This is maybe a comet or something. What does aging have to do with getting fat? So life to us is like this sock drawer. We got to get all our little ducks in a row, you know. So that's, we think we're really empowered. I know this is morally repugnant, but I don't exercise, I don't diet, and I just can't gain weight. Now just stop. I know people say that's bad. That's a bad thing. But it's because our internal dialogue is one of original sin. And the decline that we feel is that it's not fair. It's not fair that people should take a pill and get younger. So we got to work for it. We got to deserve it. I think this is more the reality. My sock drawer looks like that on a good day. Okay? And I think most of us are like Homer Simpson in the control room. I mean, think about it. If you really had to consciously wake up and manage your potassium, pretty sure you'd be dead by the afternoon. I mean, there's a lot to manage. But people go through and they have this idea that I'm in control, I gotta do good things, have good. Look at the Cochrane Report, which, as most of you know, is the evidence-based medicine for cholesterol. Hey, guess what? We do a randomized control trial of people eating low cholesterol diet. Doesn't make any difference. Eating cholesterol, I'll say it again, doesn't cause high cholesterol. Okay? If you're an Inuit on an ice floe, you're eating whale blubber or baby seal, you're gonna make carbohydrates and protein. You don't gotta eat fat to make fat. The whole system is metabolically made to interchange. You eat all carbs. You're a vegetarian from Madras and you don't eat any fat. You're going to be a fat lady if you eat a bunch of potatoes. So you're not what you eat. If we were what we eat, then we'd all have to be eating people. This guy's, oh, okay, yeah. Huh. Yeah, that makes sense. Huh. So I have 6 minutes, so let's talk about Marvin the Martian, and he's looking down on us, and let's talk about agency, because I put this slide, this is not, I apologize, it's not in your syllabus handout, but as I listen to the lectures, I realize that there's a problem of agency here. Where is the level of agency? So most people think that it's in the metabolic pathways. These are the tools, the foods we eat, the stuff we do. Other people think it's in the emergent properties, like aging, being good, healthy habits. But I think that the level of agency is on the cellular level. So Marvin's looking down. He's thinking, okay, I want to annihilate the Earth with my, you know, uranium P-38 space modulator, if you remember that. So he's looking down. He's going, I got to talk to the plants. The plants are what's controlling what's going on down there. Or I got to talk to aging or democracy. I mean, these are ideas. Even cancer, aging, these are ideas generated by our human level of experience. I mean, the P53 doesn't know it's part of a grand process of aging or paying you back for eating a cheeseburger. So I think that the level of agency is not in the toxins that we have or the oxidants in our bloodstream. The cells have the DNA. The cells make copies of themselves. The damage is in the genes. It's in the differentiation. It's in the epigenetics. So you got to have healthy cells to have a healthy body and a healthy life. Another one of the delusions that we've been given is that family history is important. I mean, I submit to you that if you live to be 200, you're going to get cancer of everything. Just as if you drove a Volvo off the lot and drove it to 200,000 miles, you're going to have to replace a lot of things. So the body, der Mensch, induced, I don't know, I can't read German, but it's like a body. So the organs are aging at different rates. So this is another problem I have with telomere measurement. It'd be like checking the tire pressure to know your carburetor or your electrical system. Telomeres are easy to measure from the blood, but that's not necessarily going to represent the bio age of your esophagus if you're a drinker, or, you know, your stomach if you like to eat kimchi, as do I. So what we're talking about is people say, oh, doc, nobody in my family ever had, you know, this, that, or the other thing. Well, a lot of the diseases, it's just they can all be created by telomere erosion. So what we're doing, even in the case of cancer therapy, we're taking junkyard parts, we're taking damaged parts, and we're asking them to fulfill their self-annihilation mission. It's not good. So this is something I mashed up in one of the webinars. It occurred to me that we could be looking at just one disease and everything. At the core of it is replicative senescence. And then failure of apoptosis, because if you can kill a cell, then a younger mesenchymal stem cell will come out of the freezer and replace. Then you have, in every organ, you have Alzheimer's, you got hypertension, macular degeneration. So really, it's Occam's razor. There's one explanation that's good enough to fit all of them. So anybody know who's on the horse? We see it's Peeping Tom. Who's on the horse? Lady Godiva, that's right, children at her feet. So we're looking at a beautiful naked lady. Maybe she was the one who was saying to, you know, the guy in Cleveland, hey, look, we can eat this thing, we can be younger. So the point is, with the loose associations and flight of ideas, is that it's pretty obvious, really, to me. I'm sitting up here like a schmuck. I'm thinking, like, does anybody not see this, that telomere erosion is a bad thing? I mean, there's 13,000 papers out there, and everyone's in their lab across getting PhDs and grants saying, guess what, doc, I figured out that, you know, telomere erosion causes esophageal cancer. Oh, that's interesting, because the guys next door figured out it causes lupus. Oh, fascinating. You know, we're going to be here. People are dying. You know, your patients are dying. We're all eroding, except the ones who are doing something about it by exercise or other means. So, you know, I think there's new ideas needed. So another kind of show of hands, who believes that all plants and animals require telomerase to maintain stem cell integrity? Show of hands. Okay, so I've convinced some of you. Other people Google it and then, you know, whatever. Who believes that protecting stem cells and their genetic stability is a good thing? Anyone? Anyone? Good. Good. And if there was a safe way to keep telomerase active and preserve those stem cells, who would want to at least try it or take it? Oh, good. So they've got some activity at the booth, maybe. All right. So lastly, if you were in perfect health, like feeling great, forever 21, would you want to live to be 1,000? Is there anybody, if they were in perfect health, who would want to live to be 1,000? Great. So it's not just the one guy. So we've dismantled a little of the hidden narrative, the guilt about being alive. So I think that's good. So instead of being born in original sin, maybe we were born free. Does anybody remember this show? Born free as the wind blows. That was good times. So they're with the lion. They're happy. You know, this is a good thing. So one man's sin is another man's salvation. On the upper right, we see Prometheus paying the price for his gift of fire to man, or technology, you could say. And then you see another Prometheus down there. That's the bristlecone pine that lives 5,000 years. So You know, I'd say those people that raise their hand, hopefully, let's say this stuff works, you do live to be a long, ripe age. Rather than, I realize that a lot of people, if they live to be 1,000, maybe this is what God was intending, they'd have a midlife crisis at 890. You know, it's, what are you doing today? Are you living your life well? Really, seriously, I mean, you gotta live every day like it's important. Because whether you know it or not, it's like running in the corner of your operating system. Everyone has the perception of death. And once that assumption changes, that you're not getting older but younger, it changes. So here's a page from my graphic novel. There's gospel, good news, that there is success and you can get hope from that. Maybe we're getting back to the garden, as Joni Mitchell? Yeah. And then we're entering an age of Aquarius, where a personal actualization, all this stuff is available to us. So this guy in my graphic novel is about a scientist who wants to live forever by downloading his consciousness into his son's body, who he actually cloned, but that's a spoiler. Anyway, so his half-brother has progeria because he was one of the clones with improper mutation from the mitochondrial DNA. I know this is getting heady again. He's being a wise guy to the Pope here, or the Cardinal. He's saying, you know, Methuselah lived 900 years, so maybe God's saying we're ready to live in the garden and walk with him. And the Cardinal says, it's spoken like a scientist. Don't forget, God can change his mind. And then Dominic says, well, you know, they used to say the world was flat, and I think the church changed its doctrine on that a little while ago. So keep an open mind. And the last quote is, I don't want to achieve immortality through my work. And Woody Allen said, I want to achieve it through not dying. So if you like sci-fi and high-concept stuff, check out my graphic novel. It's also available for free download on the iPad and iPhone. 191 pages of delectable material. And just want to thank you. This is my podcast on the left. There's 32 now. There's going to be 45. Hope to write a book about it. So these podcasts are really, they're usually an hour, and they're real patients come back and say, this got better. So I scramble to look up the why and explain it to a fifth grader level. And then I do a literature search. And then the people talk to you. And so that'll be a lot of what's presented on Sunday. So again, I want to remind you that it's not a zero-sum game. Things like love are rechargeable sources of energy. They're renewable. So everybody live their life, I hope, in peace and love. And namaste. Thank you very much. I salute you.
Man's clouded sun shall brightly arise, and songs be heard instead of sighs. God save